the last. The whole brick stuff. Di Naturalis, which is the Latin name of the book that Isaac Newton wrote, explaining an enormous amount of mathematics, physics. It is there in MLS, yes. And that book, he gave an introduction to that book and an overview of what it was and what experiments that Newton, he actually gave the talk at MLS also earlier, and he gave this talk here also. So he agreed this time to talk about, we invited him to talk about something else, and this time he moved from physics to chemistry. CNR Rao, who's a Bharat Ratna and a great scientist that India has produced, he talked about Lewis and how neglected he was and how critical he was to 20th century chemistry. So when Siddharth offered that, we are happy to take it. Siddharth is an electrical engineer by training, not profession. Then he studied, formally studied photography. He took a diploma in Ooty. He was taking decided he'd start teaching school kids, and then he decided it, physics, chemistry and so on, science. Then he decided he'd start getting into yoga and teaching yoga. I don't know what he's doing currently now. I don't know if his family themselves know what he's doing, but he is involved some way in teaching. And in THT and BSF we have this thing. We consider your job secondary to your voluntary efforts at our organization. So we don't talk too much about that particular aspect of it. Siddharth is a delightful speaker. He gave one of the summer camp programs for a couple of kids, a couple of days for school children 2 years back. He was doing a lot of experiments, some of them inspired by Arvind Gupta, who's one of our other speakers. Some of them he came up with. Two wonderful days the kids had. He does that a lot of places. He talks about heritage, he talks about science, he teaches it, he loves talking about it. He's a frequent speaker at several fora, talks on a variety of subjects. So having invited him, I don't want to stand any further between him and Gilbert Lewis. So Siddharth, take the stage.
Just give me a minute to swap the presentations. But I should say that when Gopu and I were discussing the topic of Gilbert Lewis, we came upon this idea that we will talk about the chemical discoveries of Gilbert N Lewis. But as I thought about it, and I spent a lot of time, the first thing I realized is how wrong we were. How wrong I was to even think about saying that it is the chemical discoveries of Gilbert Newton Lewis that I'll be talking about. I'd like to therefore generalize the topic and say that this will be Gilbert N. Lewis. Okay, it's not even discoveries, because as we go along, you will realize how much of things that Gilbert Lewis has done, the number of topics he's thought about. If you'd like to call him as a chemist, then he's also worked in physics. So he's a physicist. So if he's worked only in physics, then he's mentored somebody who won a Nobel Prize in biology. So what is he? So he's just Gilbert Newton Lewis, the man. There we have him with his characteristic cigar, sitting at his table at UC Berkeley, with his signature that made a lot of PhDs what they were, made a lot of students successful, and most importantly, took a lot of people to a whole lot of places. The first few slides are an overview. These have already been covered as part of the message and email that went along. But I thought I would summarize it for all of you, because if there were a few points that I would like to leave you with, these are what they are. A framework on which we can definitely take Gilbert Lewis and then just rocket, skyrocket, and go a whole bunch of directions from him. So, he is an American physical chemist. That's what Wikipedia defines him as, but I'd like to just say that he was a man of multiple hats. He was best known for his discovery of the covalent bond, the concept of electron pairs, Lewis dot structures, and contribution to valence bond theory. All of this has a chemical chemistry and its orientation. He contributed to chemical thermodynamics, photochemistry, and isotope separation. He was known for his concepts of acids and bases and researched relativity and quantum physics. As a professor, he incorporated thermodynamic principles into chemistry curriculum, of course. He changed thermodynamics from a mathematically rigorous manner to make it available for chemists as a tool that they could use in multiple ways. He was nominated 41 times for the Nobel Prize, but he didn't even win it once. This was the biggest controversy in the history of the Nobel Prize. He mentored and influenced a number of Nobel laureates at UC Berkeley. And on the campus of Berkeley, the Lewis Hall is named after him. As we go on, you will see the number of things that he's influenced. Okay? So, as Sound of Music says, let's start at the very beginning. It's a very good place to start. So, Gilbert Lewis was actually born near Massachusetts on October 25th, 1875. Today, if you go to Weymouth, which is the town where he was born, there is what is known as the G.N. Lewis Way, which is a street that is named after him. In the Weymouth High School, the chemistry department has also been is also called the Lewis Block, so it has been named after him. I feel surprised, and I also feel a little sad that the maximum recognition that he's got is from the town that he was born in, and he lived only for the first 7 years of his life. Frank Wesley Lewis, who is a lawyer of independent character, was his father, and Mary Burr White Lewis was his mother. At the age of three, he read. He was intellectually precocious, as people have said. And in 1884, when he was 9, the family moved to Nebraska, Lincoln specifically. For several years, he had very little formal schooling, and Lewis, in his speeches and his talks, frequently said that he enjoyed something that most of the world's most distinguished men enjoyed, which is that they escaped from the ordinary process of formal education. So he said that he was free, he did a bunch of things. And at the age of 13, he joined the preparatory school in the University of Nebraska. He graduated from the school into the University of Nebraska, where he completed his sophomore year. From here he goes on. His life is still not as fantastic as people would like to think. So in 1893, he transferred to Harvard, and then in 1896, he graduated in the Phillips Academy at Andover. So here what I have done is, in the previous slide, just to tell you, none of these pictures are Lewis, because I couldn't find a picture of Lewis other than him sitting with a cigar. So this is a child from the 1800s, and this is a young boy from the 1800s. Okay? But because the only pictures you find everywhere of Lewis is Lewis sitting at his desk, Lewis standing, Lewis with test tubes. Okay? And all those pictures I exhausted in the multiple slides. So this on the left is Harvard, and on the right is Phillips Academy, where he taught for a year. After he taught in Andover for a year, he returned to Harvard for his graduate work. And in 1898, he received his Master of Arts and Doctor of Philosophy in 1899. His thesis was called Some Electrochemical and Thermochemical Relations of Zinc and Cadmium Amalgams. Okay, the topic itself was so long, I spent some time thinking about it. Electrochemical and Thermochemical Relations of Zinc and Cadmium Amalgams. Okay, he's not even talking about zinc and cadmium. He's talking about amalgams of zinc and cadmium. Okay. And after this, what he did was he published it as a paper with Theodore William Richards as a joint author. In 1893, after 2 years in the university, he had already started his work about thinking about chemistry. He started working about it. And then in 1899, as part of this paper that we were talking about, he started looking at electrochemical potentials. Okay. Now this term, the electrochemical potential, was to have an influence throughout his life, and we will see how. He then traveled abroad. He went to Germany on a traveling fellowship, and in the Center of Physical Chemistry, and he studied with Walter Nernst, who was on in the left, and William Oswald on the right. Now both of these were prize-winning chemists, people who actually were doing cutting-edge research. But this is where things start to take a downhill turn, and I think had an influence on Lewis's life forever to come. So while working in Nernst's lab, he developed an apparent lifelong enmity with Nernst. And in the fall, in the coming years, Lewis would criticize and denounce his teacher's work in multiple ways, including once calling Nernst's work on his heat theorem, which is Lewis's heat theorem. He said, my belief on what Nernst has done on my heat theorem is a regrettable episode in the history of chemistry. So, it is said that a Swedish friend of Nernst, which is Wilhelm Palme, was a member of the Nobel Chemistry Committee. There is belief that he is said to have recommended Lewis multiple times for the Nobel Prize. And just out of what Lewis did to Nernst, he wrote negative reports every time the recommendation came up, so that Lewis was always rejected from the Nobel. So there is documented evidence. It has happened at least 3 times where it has been shown that Palmer actually gave negative reports. But this was to come much later. But in between, Lewis returns back to Harvard, and he becomes an instructor for 3 years. At this point, he is appointed as an instructor in thermodynamics and electrochemistry. So he's doing a lot of work. But in between, Lewis actually says, I'm going to take a break. So what he does is he takes 1 year of absence. He takes a leave of absence from in 1904 from Harvard. And he goes to Manila to become the superintendent of weights and measures for the Bureau of Science there. Okay? Here is a man who becomes a superintendent, okay, is supposed to oversee all the administrative activities, but this man is so precocious, his brain is buzzing, and he has this indefatigable pursuit of science, that he decides that he's going to write a paper there too. And he writes, he studies the decomposition of silver oxide, and he writes a paper called Hydration in Solution. Okay, here he's actually looking after weights and measures, and he's writing a paper called Hydration in Solution. And then in 1905, he returns to United States and joins a bunch of physical chemists in the MIT under A.A. Noyes, and they actually stimulate a lot of conversation about physical chemistry in the United States. The 7 years that Lewis was in that lab under A.A. Noyes is said to have marked an intensive period of scientific activity, both experimental and theoretical, and this continued through his life. There is belief and there is very concrete proof that all the results that actually were published in this, were got in this scientific activity, were published in over 30 papers, some of which actually laid the foundation for the superstructures we know today as modern physical chemistry. So a lot of them involved the study of electrode potential of elements, contributions which in later years you will see make high and earth-shattering changes to what we know as chemistry. So in one direction we have that he is actually working on a certain direction of doing his own research. On the other end, we see him publishing prolifically 30, 40 papers with people like E.B. Wilson and E.C. Tolman, etc. And then comes the big institution, University of California, Berkeley. So the chairman of the university, which is Benjamin I. Wheeler, calls him in 1912 and says, please join our institution. And when he joins his institution, he actually says, I'm going to join it as a professor of physical chemistry, but I have few stipulations. So his stipulations say that I want new facilities for research and complete departmental rejuvenation. So he actually is part of it. He completely changes the department, and suddenly you see there is this department of chemistry that is starting to do some work. In the year 19, on a side note, on July 21st, 1912, he married Mary Hinckley Sheldon, a daughter of a Harvard professor, and get this, his wife's father was a professor of romantic studies. So I think that actually was a match made to be, but I think it's just like this blip in the character we know as Gilbert Lewis. By 1912, he had already gone through these professorial grades, and he had actually become this dean of studies. And this is what they said. Before I proceed, I should tell you that in my hand, actually, I have this bunch of papers, it's 28 pages, which include a biography of Gilbert Lewis, published by, by the National Academy of Sciences, Washington, D.C. It is a memoir to him, and includes, out of 28 pages, 14 pages are the story of Lewis, and 14 pages are the bibliography of all the work he's done, including all the papers he's published. So you will see I'll have like these bunch of pages which are just bibliography. If I start reading them, it is fascinating to see the number of things he's spoken about. So as he went by, there are quotes of how he was as a professor. So it says that he recruited a group of young men who established a center of intense scientific activity. And I quote here, instructors of and professors of chemistry were what they were called. They were not of its subdivisions. No one was in a position to reserve a field or to pose as an authority therein. All met together to discuss chemistry, organic, inorganic, or physical alike. The utmost freedom in discussion was their rule. In one of the research conferences that people attended, Lewis made a deliberately challenging statement, as he loved to do, taking boyish delight in shocking conservative prejudice, whereupon a bright student, interrupted with saying, "No, sir, that isn't so." People were aghast, but Lewis turned with interest and said, "No, why not?" And there followed a lively discussion where facts and logic alone determined the outcome. Okay, here was a teacher, a person who actually changed chemistry by changing the way that it was taught. In fact, there is a statement where a student criticized one of his assertions in a lab, and Lewis looked at him and said, "This is an impertinent remark, but it is also pertinent." So the member of the department, it is said, were like Athenians who spent their time doing nothing else but either telling or hearing something new. So Lewis actually, Lewis spent a lot of time taking interest in the students that he produced, the growth of the students, the way that they progressed, the things that they did. And his chief delight was to send new graduate students to talk to members of the staff and to let them roam freely so that they may choose a particular problem that so appealed to them most strongly. Now, this, in essence for me, creates a picture of Lewis that actually clearly tells me what his mind was like. Because here was a man who was not looking at personal gain alone, but was looking at the growth of the field in particular. Chemistry was talked about, facts were discussed, logic was spoken, and he would debate freely no matter who it was, an intern, a graduate student, or people who just came to him. And he delivered lectures up to about 500 students at a time in a large chemistry auditorium with great attention to lighting. He spent time in projection and in creating the right ambience so that the full dramatic possibilities of this subject were realized by the student. However, lab work and viva and questions were conducted at only 25 students' strength. Why? Because he believed that this one-on-one interaction where logic ruled supreme was important to the growth of his students. Today, in the seminar hall where he delivered most of his lectures, there is in just about the chair that he sat, there is this huge portrait which I will show you, showing him in his characteristic pose where he would sit, recline, and have a cigar in his hand. Okay, that was Lewis for me. So his golden years, according to me, were somewhere between the years 1912 to about 1930. So what did he do? In these years, he mentored a lot of students. He brought about a lot of students, some of whom we will see later. He was supposed to have shared a Nobel Prize, but he lost out on that. Today, if we know it, UC Berkeley is one of the most reputed centers for chemistry in the world. And it is all because of Lewis. And then, as he was going through, going back a little in time, in the year 1913, what happened? We had the World War I. So, World War I interrupted Lewis's stint at California. In December 1917, he was commissioned as a major. From the year 1913 to 1917, he was contributing. But in the year 1917, he was commissioned as a major in the gas service. He was sent to France as a director of the chemical warfare service. But what happened was he was first sent to the front as an observer during the Great German Offensive. When Lewis came back, he gave such a report and such a penetrating one at that, that Amos A. Fries, who was the chief general at that point, made him the chief of the defense division of the chemical warfare service. So he actually set up the gas warfare school, where he started training people on how to handle gas warfare. At its peak, which is said to have been between 1917 and 1918, the school was training almost 200 gas officers a week. And during this time, what was actually the most biggest casualty of World War I, which was deaths by gas, had dropped to a measly number of 1 or 2%. For this, he was given the Distinguished Service Medal. I'd like to read the citation of this because it gives us a perspective of the amount of work he had done. By his unusual energy, marked ability, and high technical attainments, he rendered extremely valuable service by securing first-hand data on the uses and effects of gas and submitting reports of such value that they became the fundamentals upon which gas warfare policies of the American Expeditionary Forces were thereafter largely based. Later, as chief of the Defense Division Chemical Warfare Service, he obtained a high state of efficiency in the protection of our officers and soldiers against enemy gas and furthered the success of American arms by securing a better and more effective use of gas, especially mustard gas, against the enemy, thereby rendering services of great value to our government. Okay? So this man has taken his chemistry knowledge that he was putting in to students, trying to bring logic. He took the same thing into World War I, built an entire system of people who could combat gas, and also built more effective use of mustard gas in the World War I, and sort of tilted the tides. When he came back to Washington shortly before the end of the war, he was made a lieutenant colonel, and he was made the chief of the training division of the Chemical Warfare Service. He was also awarded the Cross of the Legion of Honor. So he comes back. Around the time of 1920, and he starts his work again. So as he keeps going, in the year 1923, his first great treatise on thermodynamics comes. This treatise represents work that began in 1899 and actually is a culmination of 60 papers on the subject that he had published. Before I get into his contribution, I just wanted to sort of bring to light where his life went. He did a lot of work, but in the year 1946, a graduate student found Lewis's lifeless body under the laboratory workbench at Berkeley. He had been working on an experiment with liquid hydrogen cyanide. What he was doing, we'll probably talk about, where it is believed that he was working on the fluorescence of organic compounds, and he was also using hydrogen cyanide. It is believed that there was a leaky pipe and hydrogen cyanide kind of leaked into the lab. The cause of death was supposed to have been coronary artery disease because there was no cyanosis. But the belief is that he committed suicide because there was a belief that Irving Langmuir, who was another great chemist, came by and taunted him and said that deuterium, which his student, Lewis's student Harold Urey, had found, was actually supposed to have been his, and that he lost it and is said to have taunted him. There is belief that Lewis also felt let down. He felt that there was no use for his work, and it was a tragedy in the end. But all of his students believe that he died doing what he knew best, which was living in the lab. As part of what he did, he was given a bunch of things. Lewis had given the world contributions that we would never forget and we can never forget. And so on that note, let us look at some of his contributions. To start with, thermodynamics. How many of us are able to think of thermodynamics as something that we would associate with chemistry? We know thermodynamics is something that physicists predominantly studied as a mathematical set of equations, formulae, and they put a bunch of things together. Chemists were trying to study chemical affinity and see why compounds formed, why elements would join together, why two reactants would actually join and form products, or why products would actually disintegrate and form the a reversible reaction, to say. And they were trying to see whether there was a heat affinity, a heat of reaction, which actually talked about the affinity. And as things went by, they never tried figuring out whether their heat or the heat of the reaction was actually truly what caused it. But Lewis took a bold step. He said, it is not the heat of the reaction, but rather a term he called fugacity. Now, fugacity is something which is actually within a gas, where it talks about how freely a gas can move around and change state. It is actually a change of state. But today, in thermodynamics, Lewis's term fugacity refers to a concept called free energy, or the energy available in a system for it to change state, either from reactants to products or products to reactants, until a certain point where the free energy is the lowest, at which time stability is reached. Now, this is a sort of a graph that shows free energy. It plots against increasing proportion of products. The graph is not important, but it shows you that there is actually a direction of spontaneous reaction that happens. And this is what Lewis was trying to do. Lewis was trying to see whether there was a spontaneous and a logical reasoning of why certain things happen in a certain way. He coined the term escaping tendency, which was his term for fugacity. And then he actually said that free energy is one part of the problem. It is not free energy alone, but he brought in another term which we today associate with thermodynamics, which is called entropy, or the degree of randomness in a system. So he says free energy combined with this entropy actually talks about why a reaction goes in a certain direction. Now, what is the problem so far? People were trying to figure this out in doing very, very ballpark guesses based on trends they had seen or certain things that had happened before. But Lewis said that this actually is not critical enough. They've not done an examination enough. So Lewis said, I will do something. I will prepare tables of free energy. So he sat and did recalculation of chemical data. This data was systematic in that Lewis sat and did experiments in the lab, measured results with such high precision that there are glowing reports of how chemists suddenly found a transformation in understanding chemistry as such. So Lewis actually and his co-workers started measuring equilibrium of chemical reactions, and he started applying thermodynamics, which is mathematical formulae, into the study of chemicals, especially solutions, and why solutions behaved in a certain manner. And he published a monograph. This monograph summarized the work of 25 years. It contained the free energies of 143 different substances. Okay. This is a man who actually, when he published it, when this monograph went for review, this is what a reviewer seems to have said. I would like to read two reviews because that talks about the scale of work. I quote, if this book can further the use of those values, here they're referring to free energy values, and can create a demand for more data, it would have added more to the development of civilization and the increase of human comfort than any other chemical treatise in all of history. In addition, another reviewer for the magazine Nature said, for many years back, the published researches of G. N. Lewis and his collaborators have occupied a prominent place in the branch of science dealing with the application of thermodynamics to the solution of chemical problems. The book now under review, of which he and his co-worker Merle Randall are joint authors, collects and summarizes these researches and places them in position in the general framework of thermodynamics. For this alone, all interested in matters pertaining to physico-chemical theory would owe him thanks. But it just gets better. But the debt is increased by the fact that no better account of modern chemical thermodynamics than appears in this book can be placed in the hands of advanced students. Okay? Now this is a review of his monograph. Okay? Lewis then took chemistry, algebra, arithmetic and graphical methods, which were actually the scope of mathematicians around the world, and started applying them to the treatment of thermodynamic data. He was getting data from his experiments. He applied it. And what it did is, applying this data and creating a set of results and a certain set of trends and theories suddenly made thermodynamics not just abstruse science that people were thinking was in dusty shelves, but actually the modern working chemist had a tool that could actually give him accurate predictions. Now, so when we spoke about his paper, which is the first paper that he published, which is the electrochemical and thermochemical properties of zinc and cadmium amalgams, he had already started talking about thermodynamics. Now, when we talk about thermodynamics, this was his magnum opus, Thermodynamics and the Free Energy of Chemical Substances, in 1923, which he had published, which had all of his work on thermodynamics. He had established equilibrium measurements, okay, and the value of measurement of the oxygen electrode, that is an oxygen electrode, okay, and shown that equilibrium values are not just directly obtained. You have to actually look at results. So when you look at it, you've seen that Lewis has taken this entire thing, he's just done one thing about applying thermodynamics. But then you realize he went much deeper. So he actually, in his paper, Outline of a New System of Thermodynamic Chemistry, started determining the electrode potential of a number of elements. Okay, and look at the list of the elements. Lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, chlorine, bromine, iodine, oxygen, mercury, silver, thallium, lead, and iron. Okay, look, if you know the periodic table, okay, which will come soon, you will see the spectrum across the periodic table that he was testing for electrode potentials. Okay, now I don't want to get into electrode potentials because it will get too theoretical and technical, but understand that he was actually looking at not a qualitative but a quantitative way of studying chemistry. Chemistry was no longer something that you actually theorized about. It was something that you could actually put down on paper and write numbers to. Now for that itself, okay, you would think that Lewis had some great work. But then he moved on, and then he looked at alkali metal electrodes. He looked at how aqueous solutions behave. He started studying the activities of ions in strong electrolytes. In 1912, he had already started synthesizing reversibly urea. And what he started doing in 1917, so imagine, in 1912, he joined Harvard, and he's talking about thermodynamics. In 1917, he's in World War I, trying to help the gas forces, and he's already doing investigation into the scope of the third law of thermodynamics. In 1921, he looked at the basis of treatment of concentrated solutions. He's just come back to Harvard, remember. He's going between Manila, he's come back to Harvard, he's now gone for the World War I, he's coming back, and suddenly he's already doing this bunch of things. He's studying thermodynamics, he's looking at solutions, he's looking at the behavior, he's looking at ions, he's looking at mathematics, he's looking at graphical theories, and you're suddenly like, man, this man can't just give up. Okay? But I'm happy he didn't, because today if we go anywhere after class 6 or class 7, there is no way you can get through one academic year of chemistry without touching something that Lewis had already brought about in the planet and the way that chemistry was further studied. Okay? And I would think that Mohan sir here as a teacher of chemistry would actually attest to this fact that everything that I have said is suddenly something that you can always talk about in every class. Okay? Now, this is something that he's already gone through. Okay? Here is work he's already done in 1923. You think this man has actually gone like ages and bounds and leaps and he's eons into the future. And then he says, okay, now I've reached somewhere, so let's move on. So he says, I'm going to study chemistry in a different angle. So he brings in valence theory. Okay. So in 1916, in the Journal of American Chemical Society, he writes a small little paper called The Atom and the Molecule. Okay. In this atom and molecule, what he does is when he studies, he sees that he understands at that time roughly that there is this concept of two electrons and this octet and the stability that comes out of an octet. But nobody understood how this octet worked. So what he started doing was he started drawing these cubes and cuboids and started saying that there was nested set of cubes and cuboids that were growing. Now if you see, we are lucky that this diagram on the left is actually Lewis's drawing in one of his papers. And if you see, it says actually in the first line that goes right across next to C and SI, it says probably some kernel inside the atom. Okay, so he's also making notes and saying probably some kernels. He's putting in plus and minus and minus, and you're seeing slowly some charges happening, because around that time, what we understood, before we move on to understanding what he did and his I don't even want to call it his magnum opus contribution, because thermodynamics was already a magnum opus. Here, it was his other fascination. So what he did is, up till this point, you understood that there was something called polar bonds, where an electron could be given, an electron could be taken, and suddenly a charge difference formed. And these two kind of attracted and they sat together. But here, what had happened is, you could only talk about these bunch of elements that could accept and this bunch of elements that could give. But what do you do with this entire bunch of elements in between? And he came up with this fantastic idea that you didn't have to give and take, you could share. Okay? So you no longer had to give and I no longer had to take. I could have, you could also have that, you could both bring it together and it suddenly made a complex contribution. Okay? Now if you look at this image on the right, there is actually hydrogen and carbon. And we see that hydrogen has one electron and we see carbon has four electrons. By the way, this representation, which is today a standard, is called the Lewis dot structure, which was his contribution again. The Lewis dot structure talks about how the bonding formed. He came up with this idea of how a covalent bond came about. And if you see water, he's already started drawing two electrons here, two electrons for oxygen. Now oxygen has six, hydrogen has one, they share, and suddenly you see that hydrogen is taking from sharing one of oxygen, and hydrogen has got its duo, which is the two electrons complete. Oxygen is taking from the two hydrogen, then it's got its eight complete, and suddenly you form stability. Now, where does this lead us? It leads us to actually the biggest shift we know in chemistry, which is the study of carbon and its compounds, or the big area we know as organic chemistry. Because if we didn't know this covalent bond, we could never understand why carbon behaved the way it did. If we didn't know that sharing happened with electron pairs or a set of electrons, we could never understand why a single bond happened, why a double bond happened, why a triple bond happened. And understanding this, looking at the mathematics of it, understanding how strong the compound was and how easily you could break it, you could suddenly start looking at saying that sodium chloride, which is salt, is an ionic compound and therefore has a very strong attraction and stays strong by the idea that you heated it and it took a lot of heat to actually break it apart. You could study the entire aspect of why chemicals were chemicals, why something behaved this way it did. It looked at octets, it looked at a bunch of things, and it looked at exactly why the electron structure behaved the way it did. Now this created a big conflict, because here were physicists who were looking at a big, I don't get any word in English, but the Pitamaha, you want to call it, of physics. Niels Bohr, who had drawn this huge structure, and here was a man who was talking about octets, who was talking about the way that interactions happen, give and take no longer beginning to work. And then he looked at this sharing, and suddenly he said that this electron structure and this way it shared started affecting the magnetic properties of these compounds. Okay? Now here you see he's sort of transgressing the boundary between physics and chemistry, and he's saying magnetic properties but of chemical substances based on electron structure. Now you don't know which space you are in, but he's suddenly now starting to create this blurred boundaries, which suddenly starts to define this magnificence of science. And Langmuir, with whom he had his final argument, seems to have said of his valence theory, "The theory of valence recently advanced by G. N. Lewis seems to offer by far the most satisfactory picture of the mechanism of chemical combination that has yet been suggested." Now, this was not accepted as much, but later as time went by, another great of chemistry, Linus Pauling, came by. He started doing his studies. There was suddenly this field of quantum mechanics and quantum physics coming in. And suddenly Linus Pauling was looking at Lewis, his structures, his ideas of the valence theory, and suddenly he started seeing that there was a connection. So Linus Pauling said, and I quote, "The application of quantum mechanics to the interaction of more complicated atoms and to the non-polar chemical bond in general is now being made. It is worthy of mention that the qualitative conclusions which have been drawn are in complete equivalence with G.N. Lewis's theory of the shared electron pair." Okay? Now here is quantum mechanics, the leap in science, saying that we have complete equivalence between G.N. Lewis's theory on the shared electron pair and our quantum mechanic understanding. Okay. Now, as we move on, Lewis said, this is not the only place I will go. He suddenly started looking at a bunch of things where acids and bases was a reaction that we knew. So acid plus base makes salt and water. We know this as a very common thing. But for some reason, the Lowry Bronsted, who were the precursors to Lewis, started always saying that an acid is a proton donor and a base is a hydroxyl donor, which or a proton acceptor. Okay, which meant that if you had to be a proton donor, you needed to have a hydrogen somewhere there with a positive charge to be donated and to be taken. But Lewis said, not all chemical reactions have hydrogen involved in between. So he said, what do I do? So he says, there is something wrong in this entire mechanism. So Lewis said, I'm going to change this. And he says, a Lewis acid is an electron acceptor. It takes an electron. So when you donate a proton, it's sort of an electron acceptor. If you can think about it, it sort of brings about a connection between the theories. But he said, it's an electron acceptor, and a Lewis base is an electron donor. So now what happens is, because you have removed the proton or the hydrogen out of it, you could have a whole plethora of chemicals that became Lewis acids or Lewis bases and reacted. So for example, here you have ammonia, which is a Lewis base, and you have BF3, which is a Lewis acid. They're reacting together, and you form a new compound, and you see there is only hydrogen here, but the hydrogen is not being donated. There's actually an electron that's moving. And when he moved this like this, what happened was the limitation of having to donate a proton or accept a proton suddenly went out of the picture. And in the acids and bases, the paper that he wrote in the year 1938, suddenly started saying that instances such of acid-bases reactions could be much wider, such as pyridine and triethylamine reacting with sulfur dioxide and BCl3, okay, and SnCl4 also reacting with sort of pyridine in solvents such as dioxane and CCl4, which is carbon tetrachloride. Okay, let's not get bogged down by the chemical names here, but what we see is in this entire combination, we see that the hydrogen has just gone out of the picture. And suddenly what happens is, the organic chemist who was looking at the proton acceptor, proton donor system, now had a much more versatile tool that he could deal with in his study of chemistry. And suddenly, organic chemistry and physical chemistry, inorganic chemistry, the boundary was not too wide apart, but sort of was intersecting. And all because Lewis said, I don't agree with the standard theory that we have today. So here we have Lewis, who's taken thermodynamics, turned it upon his head. He's taken valence theory, turned it upon his head, used his valence theory, turned the entire process of acids and bases on its head. And you would think, oh my God, this man has already done enough. So he decides to move on to weighty water. What is weighty water? Heavy water. I like the alliteration of weighty water, so I went with weighty water. But it is essentially heavy water, where hydrogen in water is replaced by an isotope of hydrogen called deuterium. Now, what had happened is, when he was studying deuterium, he had a student called Hetzi Ure, who we will look upon, who had done his degree in Berkeley under Lewis on the isolation of deuterium. So Lewis was actually said, I'm going to do something different. So Lewis actually took experiments, turned it upon their head, and he was the first to produce a pure sample of deuterium oxide, which is heavy water. And then he actually took this, and you'd think he'd kind of say, I've made heavy water, and he'd rest. He said, no, I'm going to study the survival and growth of life forms in heavy water. And then he takes deuterons, which is deuterium the nuclei, and he accelerates it in Ernst O. Lawrence's cyclotron and starts studying the properties of atomic nuclei. Okay, he here is a man who say who goes to chemistry. He takes biology and says, I'm going to study the growth and survival of life forms in chemistry, in this new chemical compound that I have. And then he takes the nuclei of this, bombards them into cyclotrons and says, I'm going to study atomic nuclei. Okay? All with this one little isotope of hydrogen we call deuterium. Okay? Think of this man, okay, going crazy. Because here is a man, in 1923, he had published this. By 1927, he had published valence theory. In 1933, he was producing deuterium and heavy water. He actually started looking at different compounds, and then he, before we proceed further, I should tell you, this was a man who had an impeccable and outstanding sense of wit. So one of his research students and a visiting faculty were passing by, and they noticed that Lewis was walking around with his entire long cellophane tube, which was actually meant for osmosis. And they asked him, what are you doing? And you'd think he was going to say osmosis and all of this. So he looked up to him and said, I'm trying to make heavy water with an artificial bladder. So here was a man who was taking a simple mundane thing of creating water with a bladder, and he said, I'm creating heavy water with an artificial bladder. Okay? A man who could think on his feet while he did all of these scientific advancements in his head. Around this time, Lewis had a research student who stayed on for postdoctoral work. His name was Glenn T. Seaborg. Okay? We will see why he's important. Okay? And what happened there is, as he was doing this, Lewis said that in 1924, we're jumping timelines because this is contributions, and these contributions cannot be put into blocks because here he's studying thermodynamics, he's studying chemistry, he's studying a bunch of things. In 1924, he's trying to study the mechanical properties, magnetic properties of oxygen, solutions of oxygen in liquid nitrogen. And he found that O4, or tetraatomic oxygen, is found. Now today it is actually a very transient thing. Tetraatomic oxygen is transient. But what happens is, when computer simulations were done, we realized that his predictions of what tetraatomic oxygen was and why it formed and the conditions for its forming are actually not very far off from the actual predicted conditions. Now, it has to do with the anti-parallel spins, the transient nature of things, but we're not going to get into that. And then we think that Lewis has done a bunch of things. He's moved to chemistry, he's taken physics, he's like glided into these spaces where people were scared to tread. And then he says, I'm going to do something different. And what does he decide to do? He decides that he liked to engage in his next flight of fancy, which is look at relativity and quantum physics. In 1908, he had met Albert Einstein, and he decided to publish his first of his many papers on relativity, where he derived the mass-energy relationship in a different way from Einstein. Okay, in 1908. In 1909, he and Richard C. Tolman combined their methodologies and came up with a specific method for special relativity. In 1912, he and E.B. Wilson actually presented a work in mathematical physics which applied to synthetic geometry and study of space-time. Okay, here is a man who's already looking at it, and in the year 1916, he's actually trying to study this entire bunch of relativity and space and time. And he writes to a bunch of magazines. But in the year 1926, he actually sends a letter to the Nature magazine, where he uses a term which for the first time is seen in the parlance of physics, chemistry, or science as such. So he looks at a structural element and says, I'm going to call this structural element photon. So he uses this term to talk about a structural element that actually is a unit of radiant energy. He talks about an element which is quantum in nature, and he says this is going to behave in a certain manner. And he actually sort of comes up with this theory of what Einstein is starting to call light quantum. And you would think this man had enough and had already done a bunch of things here. But then he says, I'm going to now think about how light behaves. So he starts talking about what is known as the delayed choice experiment. Now, have some of you heard of the delayed choice experiment? Yes? So the delayed choice experiment actually is an experiment that attempts sort of to decode whether light sometimes senses experimental apparatus in its way, which is specifically in the double slit experiment, and whether it adjusts its behavior according to these double slits, or whether it stays in its general behavior as light is normally. Okay. Now, what we must realize is this experiment, this thought experiment, which is the delayed choice experiment, was not to be proposed at least till the 1980s. Okay. This happens in the year 1926, he's proposing it. The next time we see it proposed is in the 1980s. Okay. So you see this huge jump. Okay. So having done all of this, you'd think this man had done enough. Okay. But before we proceed and talk about his other achievements, I put this picture here for a very, very specific reason. Here is the Gilbert Newton Lewis Medal for achievement in the theoretical aspects of chemistry. And in the year, on November 27, 1951, on the right side, do you see who it has been awarded to? Linus Pauling. So here is a man who is studying the quantum and the cutting edge. And here is a medal in the honor of somebody for the theoretical aspects of chemistry. So Gilbert Newton Lewis Medal goes to Linus Pauling, a man who eulogized, who idolized, and I think today if we know Gilbert Lewis, it is because of Linus Pauling, because that's the man who spoke for Gilbert Lewis. Gilbert Lewis also proposed an empirical equation to describe the failure of strong electrolytes to obey the law of mass action. I don't want to get into what that is. Over the course of his career, and this is the important part, Lewis published on many other subjects besides those mentioned, including nature of light quanta, and get this, to the economics of price stabilization. Okay, so this is a man who's a chemist, who's studied physics, who's looked at biology, and has written a paper on the economics of price stabilization. Okay, he's also in between looked at color and why color behaves in a certain way. Just give me a minute, because somewhere, here it is. So Gilbert Lewis stayed on as a professor until the age of 70. Okay. He was not content with his administrative duties. So Lewis actually wanted to occupy his mind, because he had already started studying fluorescence. He had started studying how phosphorescence happened in organic materials. He started studying the emission of light from when one electron is excited from its triplet state, studying the spin vectors, orientation of spin vectors, and also measured paramagnetism of these states, etc. Okay. He was looking at fluorescence, he was looking at colors, he was looking at colors that were caused by electron structure, he was looking at organic compounds and the phosphorescence and fluorescence they created, and he was not content. So he said, I'm getting to 70, I need to find something for recreation. So he went and he joined what is known in 1945 as a chit-chat club in San Francisco, and his first presentation to them was an introduction to American prehistory. So here was a man who was talking from price stabilization, he was talking about American prehistory, he was talking about balance theory, he was talking about the way that thermodynamics affected, and suddenly I think this man had something to do with climate change, because in the year 1945 he got one of his other flights of fancy and he wrote a paper on the thermodynamics of glaciation, or the thermodynamics on why glaciers form. Okay, now you'd think glaciers are a natural phenomenon. Here's a man studying why the thermodynamics of glaciers work the way they did. And he published two papers, by the way, in 1924 and 1925. The 1925 was for the Economic Journal, which is called A Plan for Stabilizing Prices. Okay? This man had done all of this, but 41 times and no luck. Can you believe? After all of this, 41 times you get nominated, you're called, they tell you you've been nominated, and he does not get the Nobel Prize. I'm thinking, there is something here that is not adding up. But the next few slides attempt to cover some of the students that he mentored, and all of these students are Nobel laureates. Okay? All of them. Okay? And you will see that in one case, there is three consecutive years his students win. The first is Harold Urey. Harold Clayton Urey actually did pioneering work in isotopes, and he won the Nobel Prize in Chemistry for the study of deuterium. If I remember it right, it was in the year 1959, Harold Urey. And Harold Urey also did the Miller-Urey experiment, where he looked at the conditions that are thought to have been there in early Earth, and the study of the origin of life under these conditions. During World War II, under the Manhattan Project, Urey actually turned his knowledge of isotope separation and started working on uranium enrichment. He actually looked at developing gaseous diffusion, which is, till the early post-war period, the predominant way of successfully purifying uranium. Then we have William Francis Jouk. He was an American chemist and a Nobel laureate in the year 1949 for study of matter at temperatures close to absolute zero. So we see the thermodynamics connection here. So he started doing studies in the third law of thermodynamics. He created a system, a magnetic refrigeration device, that reached closer to absolute zero than anybody had reached before. He also worked in creating theories and experiments and processes to purify compounds and naturally available materials that today has led to stronger steel, better gasoline, and a bunch of better processes in various industries. Glenn Seaborg, the man who is an American chemist who synthesized, discovered, and investigated 10 transuranium elements, and shared the 1951 Nobel Prize. So sorry, Urey was 1949, we have 1950, and we have 1951. Okay, all students of Gilbert Lewis. When the actinide series that we know it was jointly discovered by Seaborg, and Seaborg had the rare distinction of having an element named after him in his own lifetime. So Seaborg co-discovered plutonium, americium, curium, berkelium, californium, einsteinium, fermium, mendelevium, nobelium, and finally element 106, which he discovered, was called seaborgium. After the 1951 Nobel Prize, he has the astra. He's had a bunch of things named after him. An asteroid 4856 Seaborg is also named after him. And he's also a holder of a record in the Guinness Book of World Records. Can anybody guess what the record would be? The record is the person with the longest entry in the who's who of America. So this is the man who's had the longest entry in the who's who of America, and he's held the Guinness Book of World Records. Next we have William Libby, William Libby was a physical chemist who actually, in the year 1960, won the Nobel Prize for his pioneer work of studying carbon-14, the isotope, and radiocarbon dating, which we used to study prehistoric minerals, fossils, etc. So this was a man who also worked on improving the sensitivity of Giger counters, which actually measure radiation, and a man who actually looked, again worked with Harold Libby, with Urey, etc., in the Manhattan Project and the gaseous diffusion. We then come to the last of the students that we will see, Melvin Calvin. Melvin Calvin was a biochemist who actually is known in 1961 for the Nobel Prize in Chemistry for the discovery of what is known as the Calvin cycle. The Calvin cycle, they used carbon-14 as a tracer, which is again a work of Harold Libby, and they studied the route of carbon traveling during the process of photosynthesis. So here was a process where you saw how food actually traveled through a plant, the process of photosynthesis and how it worked in a plant. Okay. So here was a man who did multiple things, who went multiple ways. He was a man of wide interests. He had a sparkling sense of humor. He loved good company. He always made it better by joining it, is what his co-workers said. He was sensitive to humbug and pretense. He hated public engagements and talking, and he only delivered scientific lectures, and that too two or three. He hated laudatory speeches, and therefore his friends would always organize dinners where the only thing that was important was having a good time. One thing that Lewis did in the UC Berkeley was have people terrified of him, because nobody wanted to cross swords with this man in an academic debate. Because here was a man who could cut through everything, and in the American, in the Senate, he made such persuasive statements that no one had a repartee or a rebuttal. It is said, though, that with a pen, he showed his skill chiefly. In his preface to the work Thermodynamics, this is what he writes, and I think it's a marvelous piece of literature. He says, and I quote, "There are ancient cathedrals which, apart from their consecrated purpose, inspire solemnity and awe. Even the curious visitor speaks of serious things with hushed voice, and as each whisper reverberates through the vaulted nave, the returning echo seems to bear a message of mystery. The labor of generations of architects and artisans have been forgotten. The scaffolding erected for their toil has long since been removed. Their mistakes have been erased and have been hidden by the dust of centuries. Seeing only the perfection of the completed whole, we are impressed as by some superhuman agency. But sometimes we enter such an edifice that is still partly under construction. Then the sound of hammers, the reek of tobacco, the trivial jests bandied from workman to workman enable us to realize that these great structures are but the result of giving to ordinary human effort a direction and purpose." He also said, "Science has its cathedrals built by the efforts of a few architects and of many workers." He's a man of great tastes. He had honorary degrees from the University of Chicago, Liverpool, Madrid, Pennsylvania, Wisconsin. He was elected to the Royal Institution of Great Britain. He was called to the Swedish Academy, the Danish Academy, the Indian Academy of Sciences. He was awarded the Nichols, Gibbs, Davy, Arrhenius, Richards, and Society of Arts and Science medals. He was elected to the National Academy of Sciences in 1913, a year after joining Harvard. He served for a term as the chairman of the section of chemistry. In 1934, he resigned predominantly to talk about the injustice that he felt had been given when he was not awarded the Nobel Prize which his student, which is Harold Urey, got for deuterium. His end came suddenly. He, as we all saw, he was a man who did what he knew best, which was working in the lab. He had two sons, Richard Newton and Edward Sheldon, who both became chemists and scientists after him. He was a man who did much to change what we know as chemistry today. And one of his collaborators, G.E. Gibson, who worked with him on thermodynamics and the valence theory, I think summed it up best in his memorial resolution. The half century which terminated with the death of Gilbert Newton Lewis will always be regarded as one of the most brilliant in the history of scientific discovery. And his name ranks among the highest in the roster of those that made it great. The electron theory of chemical valence, the advance of chemical thermodynamics, the separation of isotopes, which made possible the use of deuteron in the artificial transmutation of elements, the unraveling of the complex phenomena of adsorption, fluorescence, and phosphorescence of organic dyes are among the achievements which will ever be associated to his name. The methods which he chose were always simple and to the point. He was impatient of unnecessary elaboration, and like Sir Humphrey Davy, who was one of his heroes, loved to make important discoveries with a few test tubes and simple chemicals. When the point at issue seemed to him to be sufficiently important, he would not hesitate to employ apparatus requiring skill and the delicacy of manipulation, as in the beautiful but difficult experiment which he and Calvin demonstrated the paramagnetism of the phosphorescent triplet state. He was ever cautious of the necessity for economy of time in research, and out of the wealth of his ideas was careful to select those that would lead swiftly to the goal. As a man, he was a great soul whose inspiration will never be forgotten by those who knew and loved him. He was one of those rare scientists like J.J. Thomson and Rutherford, who are also great teachers and leaders of a school, so that their influence is multiplied by the many they have inspired. His brain was still fertile of ideas, and his faculties all were unimpaired until the very end. And when he died suddenly of heart failure, he died in harness, as he would have wished it, in the act of performing his last experiment. Thank you. Any questions? Sure.
You told about valence theory. Can you make it as an electronic theory of chemistry?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
You have told about valence theory.
Yeah.
You have told about electronics and chemistry. Can you say, can we call it as an electronic theory of chemistry? Because it's the difference between physics and chemistry is getting blurred.
You can call it an electron theory of chemistry. He didn't call it chemistry at all. He just said the of atoms and molecules. He just called it his valence theory. At no point, and if I have said that, I'm sorry, but at no point did he ever say it was chemistry. He just said that he was giving a new theory of how chemicals form. He didn't say it was either physics, he didn't say it was either chemistry. He just said that he had a new theory. So you can call it whatever. He just called it his valence theory.
Who doesn't?
Either everything is gone over their head or everything is like understood.
Sure. And the younger brother of Dr. K. Narayan was a Bachelor of Chemistry Award winner. And the elder brother of Dr. K. Balasubramaniam was a professor of chemistry in the Department of Chemistry. IIT. Both are 89 years old.
Ah.
Now we are going to conduct a next year big seminar, national international, in honor of them. in the, what I want to say, I read the book of physical chemistry. I brought from America. So I am not remembering this word, Lewis. Might be that. I have to go and check again. Because you have said so much great of that. Lewis.
Can I just add that there was, I don't remember who in my readings. I remember if it was right, who was that? Sorry, Linus Pauling. Yes, it was Linus Pauling who said, here was a man that the history of science forgot. I'm pretty sure that most history of science books would have forgotten about Gilbert Lewis. They would have, if you actually go onto even Wikipedia, tetraatomic oxygen, it just says, was first proposed by Gilbert Lewis. Okay, he synthesized it. He also said that it is formed. The thought experiment is also attributed to Dirac. It is said that he actually worked on it. It is also said that Wheeler worked on it. But it says first proposed by Gilbert Lewis. Okay, all work on Gilbert Lewis today, if you have to search Google, you literally have to use a sieve, throw in all data, and you will get a handful and sprinkling of the name Gilbert Lewis. But this man, if you read, and you have to read the right sources, has done so much for chemistry that we know today, and I think I will stand my ground to say it is a pity, to say the least, that chemistry has forgotten.
Thank you. I will come back to that.
Thank you, Siddharth. That was wonderful, actually. There is so much that he has done, it's difficult to explain. Maybe it would have taken a bit more time, particularly with the covalent bonds, because that also happened to be the title of the talk, and left some of the other things in the passing. Not that I, you know, what I want to know is, when before Lewis talked about covalent bonds.
Okay.
From the time of Mendeleev and even before that, there has been an understanding of how compounds were formed, you know, what had affinity with what, and so there was a fair amount of data already.
Correct.
Only the mechanism of how they were coming together was not known, because the finding of electron itself was down the line, and understanding of nucleus etc. happened later, and quantum mechanics started happening around that time. What exactly was Lewis's contribution with respect to the covalent bonds? That was new from any of the understanding earlier.
So the contribution of Lewis is actually, to look at it, very simple. So we all knew, even much before Lewis, actually if you look at it, Laurie Blomstedt for that matter, or even before that, they were all talking about the fact that there could be bonding that happened where a give can happen and a take can happen, where usually we understood that a bond that we know it, or something happened, was due to a donor and an acceptor being there. And that a physical charge difference actually caused the bond. Here, Lewis actually looked at it and then said, if I am going to give and take, then if I were to, so actually to kind of just take an example, if I were to be carbon, for example, he said if carbon had to take, then something had to give. If you had elements like sodium, they have one, therefore they can give. But if you had something like, say, chlorine, and carbon forms carbon tetrachloride with chlorine. Chlorine also needs an electron. Carbon has 4, and if it had to give 4, which means it would become 4 plus because of the 4 extra protons in its nucleus, which essentially meant of sort it would be such so positive that you couldn't have stability ever.
I'll stop with this. Now, carbon and chlorine, you have this issue.
Hmm.
But take something very simple as methane.
Okay.
Why not, though we know today what is actually happening, at the time, why can't we think of it as hydrogen has actually given it away and carbon had actually taken it?
Because what had happened at that point is hydrogen being given away was actually a definition of a Lowry-Bronsted acid, a proton donor, which meant that hydrogen itself was an acid. Here they were looking at it as an acid-base reaction. So if it's an acid-base reaction, carbon was supposed to have been the base, which it is not. So what the understanding was that methane itself as a gas was supposed to, that is, acid plus base will give you salt plus water. But suddenly you saw that methane was not a salt. Methane was gaseous. So people then lost this connect of why there was this thing. And then he said it is not about a reaction of give and take where there is a donor and an acceptor. There is a share where it is an electron pair. He used the term electron pair, where two electrons pair together to make a pair. This pair is actually shared, and that is what holds it. So carbon has an affinity towards the electron of hydrogen, and hydrogen has an affinity towards carbon, and therefore neither of them gives up their electron, but they still complete their octet because of the proximity. Now what happened therefore is, now they say that there's a bond. Having done this, you could also talk about the variety. So for example, if a reaction happened, if you took methane, you can actually replace hydrogen there with a chlorine and make it CHCl3. If there was a donation, you would never understand why that happened and how carbon was donating back. How you could break a hydrogen between carbon and hydrogen and add a chlorine there. CHCl3 is formed. Of course it's formed. CHCl3, CH2Cl2, CHCl3 and CCl4. It slowly you can replace hydrogen with chlorine, and it goes all the way till chloroform and then carbon tetrachloride. But essentially the idea I'm trying to say is, earlier because donation happened, you couldn't understand how hydrogen got replaced by chlorine.
முன்னாடாச்சு கிளாஸ் எடுத்து தமிழே சொல்கிறேன். எனக்கு ரொம்ப ஃபேசினேட்டிங்காக இருக்கும் இந்த விஷயம். ஹைட்ரஜன் இருக்குன்னு அது ஒரு எலக்ட்ரானை கொடுத்துட்டு ப்ளஸ் ஆகிடுது, சிஎல்ங்கிறது வாங்கிட்டு மைனஸ் ஆகிடுது, ப்ளஸ்ஸும் மைனஸும் அட்ராக்ஷனுக்கு இது அர்த்தம் இருக்கு இல்லையா. இப்போ நார்த் போல் வைக்கிறோம், சவுத் போல் இருக்கும், ஒட்டிக்கும், அதான் பாண்டுன்னு சொல்கிறோம். அவர் என்ன சொன்னார், ஜிஎன் லூயிஸ் என்ன சொன்னார், 8 எலக்ட்ரான்னு சொன்னார். இப்போ இவர் கேட்டார் இல்லையா, அந்த க்வெஸ்சன் இங்கே தான் வரும். கொஞ்சம் பையனை கொஞ்சம் யோசிக்க வச்சா எப்படின்னா, 2 எலக்ட்ரானுமே நெகட்டிவ் தானே, சார்ஜ் நெகட்டிவ் தானே. இவர் ஷேரிங்னு சொல்கிறார் இல்லையா, குளோரினுக்கு வந்து அவுட்டர் மோஸ்டில் வந்து 7 எலக்ட்ரான், கடைசியாக ஒன்று இருக்குது, இந்த குளோரினுக்கு ஒன்று இருக்குது, ரெண்டு இருக்குது, ரெண்டு நெகட்டிவாக எப்படி ஒன்னோட ஒன்று இருக்க முடியும். குளோரினுக்கு எந்த சார்ஜும் இல்லை, இந்த குளோரின் ஆட்டத்துக்கும் சார்ஜ் இல்லை, அப்போ ரெண்டு எப்படி ஒட்டிக்கும், ரெண்டு ஒட்டுறது சார்ஜ் பாண்டுங்கிறது ஒட்டிக்கிறது தானே, அது பிரேக் பண்ணுறதே கஷ்டம். இப்போ ஹைட்ரஜன் உடைக்கிறது கூட 180 கிலோ கேலரிஸ் தேவைப்படுதுங்கிறாங்க ஹைட்ரஜனை பிரிக்கிறதுக்கு. ஹைட்ரஜனில் ஒரு சார்ஜ் கிடையாது, இந்த ஹைட்ரஜனையும் சார்ஜ் கிடையாது, அப்புறம் ரெண்டு எப்படி ஒட்டிகிட்டு இருக்கு. தட் இஸ் ஃபேசினேட்டிங். அந்த பாண்டுக்கு பேர் தான் கோவேலன்ட் பாண்டு. அந்த கோவேலன்ட் பாண்டு எப்படி வரணும், ப்ளஸ்ன்னு சொன்னால் மைனஸும் அட்ராக்ட் பண்ணிக்கும், 2 எலக்ட்ரான நடுவில் இருக்கும்போது எப்படி சார் பாண்டு உண்டாகும், என்ன அது பிசின் மாதிரியா ஒட்டிக்குதா அப்படின்னா, லூயிஸ் என்ன சொல்கிறாரு, அதனுடைய ஸ்ட்ரக்சர் வந்து 8 எலக்ட்ரான் வந்த பிறகு 2 எலக்ட்ரானும் ஷேர் பண்ணிக்குது அப்படிங்கிறாரு. அப்போ ஒரு க்வெஸ்சன் வரும், எலக்ட்ரான்கிறதே நெகட்டிவ், இன்னொரு எலக்ட்ரான் பக்கத்தில் எப்படி இருக்கும், ஒன்னோட ஒன்று மோதிக்காதா இல்லையா. அதுக்கு அவர் எப்படி எக்ஸ்பிளைன் பண்ணுறாருன்னா, அந்த 2 எலக்ட்ரான் வந்து இந்த பக்கம் இருக்கக்கூடிய ஒரு ப்ரோட்டான் நியூக்ளியஸ்ன்னு இருக்கு இல்லையா, அதில் பாசிட்டிவ் சார்ஜ் இருக்கும், அதை பிடிச்சி இழுக்குமா, இந்த ஆட்டமும் பிடிச்சி இழுக்குமா, அதனால அது நடுவில் இருக்கும். அதனால தி ரிப்பல்சிவ் ஃபோர்ஸ் ஆஃப் தி 2 எலக்ட்ரான்ஸ் இஸ் கவுண்டர் பேலன்ஸ்டு பை தி அட்ராக்டிவ் ஃபோர்ஸ் ஆஃப் தி 2 நியூக்ளியை. இந்த பக்கம் பிடிச்சி எடுக்குது, இந்த பக்கம் பிடிச்சி எடுக்கிறதுனால நடுவில் அப்படி நின்றுட்டு இருக்கு, அதை உடச்சி எடுக்கவே முடியாது அப்படிங்கிறாங்க. அதனால தான் ஹைட்ரஜனுக்கு அவ்வளோ ஸ்ட்ரென்த் அப்படிங்கிறாங்க பாண்டு. அதை இப்போ எப்படி எக்ஸ்பிளைன் பண்ணுறாங்கன்னா, இப்படி ஒரு அட்டாமிக் ஆர்பிட்டால்லாம் சொல்கிறாங்க, அது இன்னொன்று வந்து ஓவர்லேப் ஆகுதுன்னு சொல்லுவாங்க. இப்போ மோஸ்ட் மாடர்னாக சொல்லுவோம், மாலிகுலர் ஆர்பிட்டால் தெரியுன்னு, ஒன்னோட ஒன்று ஓவர்லேப் ஆகும்போது இந்த நெகட்டிவ் ரிப்பல்சிவ் ஃபோர்ஸஸ் எல்லாம் போயிட்டு அட்ராக்ட் ஆகுது. ஆனால் ஃபேசினேட்டிங்காக இருக்கும், வெறும் 2 ஹைட்ரஜனை உடைக்கிறதுக்கு அவ்வளோ எனர்ஜி வேணும், ஒரு சார்ஜ் ஒரு அட்ராக்டிவ் பவர் கிடையாது, ஒன்றும் கிடையாது. ஆனால் இந்த எலக்ட்ரான் நடுவில் வந்து இவர் சொன்னார், இந்த கோவேலன்ட் பாண்டுங்கிற ஒரு பாண்டை ப்ரொடியூஸ் ஆகுது. இட்ஸ் வெரி ஃபேசினேட்டிங் ரியலி. அதனால் தேங்க்யூ.
I didn't want to get into such detail, but actually Lewis on the bond mattum solala, he also says in the electrons inge irukkum bodhu ஒண்ணுக்கு வந்து clockwise spin இருக்கு ஒண்ணுக்கு counter clockwise spin இருக்கு அப்படினு கூட சொல்றாரு which is quantum state but he is also looking at spins in triplet state right. So in the details I didn't want to get into
but because இதர் ரெண்டு பேர் இருக்காங்க spin state னா அவ்வளவுதான்
இல்ல அதுக்கு தான் நான் I didn't want to go
இல்ல see kind of hard to explain some of these things just by words you need some pictures you need some I think those things help in the I think Badri's point tended to see there's a history of understanding of what an acid is right before Lavoisier they had no clue they generally think name things on acid Lavoisier gave it an oxygen type of acid and they realized that you don't really need oxygen you know there are things like hydrochloric acid doesn't have oxygen so throughout the last 200 years there has been five different definitions of what an acid is similarly with bases alkalis and so on so that historical point you were saying I think that's what you're trying to go
okay for. I understand
that is that covalent aspect and the acid aspect knowledge yeah.
So that would have actually been covered if I had gone into the depth of covalent bond but because it was chemical discoveries of Lewis I thought I would rather show you the spectrum of what Lewis has done rather than show you a dipstick into each of this so just a choice
So thank you Siddharth for a very illuminating lecture about a very little known person very well done brother mudla nari pere so I think one you have enough material for another you know enough questions raised for giving another talk perhaps sometime later on some of the aspects of right so if there is enough curiosity இதுக்கு முதல்ல கூட்டம் வரட்டும் அப்புறம் வந்து அடுத்த அந்த பயத்துக்கு இது ஒண்ணு சோ ஐ திங்க் as much as the lecture வந்து for the first time 10 வருஷமா காந்தியை தவிர இலக்கியத்தை தவிர எதுவுமே பேசாத மோகன் கெமிஸ்ட்ரி பேச வச்சது வந்து தூங்கிட்டு இருந்த சிகத்தை கிளப்பி விட்டாரு சித்தார்த்த அப்படின்னு சோ ஐ திங்க் we'll have Mohan sir give a lecture sometime soon in science so who better than our own Gilbert Lewis Mr. Mohan to give a little token of our appreciation to Siddharth yes sir so next month in the party now we had to do it on the fourth saturday third saturday rather than the fourth saturday because TBA had blocked their hall for some other program the next saturday there's a suggestion that next month also we do it on the third saturday because fourth saturday 26 is the fourth saturday 26 and 27 are Deepavali so we don't want to disrupt the one for a special exception next month alone we are going to try to get it we don't know what the TBA this thing is we'll send it out and you know get the program we'll you know pass the information on to you once we know the date for sure next month is going to be a slightly different program we are going even younger than Siddharth we are in fact going to have a collection of a set of school children talk about various things that they have accomplished in schools we don't want to stress out any single student to do a 1.25 hour talk that one it will be unfair on them and it may not be you know it may not be perfectly correct for the audience also so we're going to get 4 or 5 students to show different aspects of what they have done and of different ages also 7th standard la 12th standard varaikum we are trying to get we may even get our regular 2nd standard student is missing today so we'll get a bunch of students to give a talk about you know various aspects of science that they are doing they have exhibited showcased there's a couple of one of the two things that impressed me was one of the school kids you're talking about is a corporation student a set of students who conducted an experiment won an award went to Singapore for it and another went to Germany for it so we are bringing them over also and then we're going to give a talk so very interesting things that people are doing so that is going to be the program the names and the what the programs are we'll reveal when we get the auditorium we'll let you know thank you have a good evening Thank you.